turn this over to Jordan Damerel, and I'm going to let him tell you about himself. All right. Here you go. And it's all yours.
Thanks, Robert. Hi, everyone. My name is Jordan Damerel. I am the district engineer up at Fairfield-Suisun Sewer District up in the North Bay. I'm really happy to have you all here today and to give you some hopefully useful information to help you prepare for your wastewater operator exam. So as you know, there's two sessions of wastewater today. I'll be starting this morning with an overview of clarifiers, talking a little bit about primary and secondary clarifiers. And then Monty Hamamoto will follow up a little bit later with some discussion of activated sludge. So we've got a lot to cover, so I'm gonna move pretty quick. Feel free to add comments in the chat. And Robert, I think you're gonna help me keep an eye on those, right?
Yes, I am.
Okay, thank you. So, all right, here we go. Here's my contact info. Hopefully you have a copy of these slides. Feel free to reach out if you have any questions. So our learning objectives for today. Firstly, we wanna refresh and just make sure we all know what's the point of a primary clarifier and a secondary clarifier. We wanna understand what operational parameters we need to look at to make sure that the clarifier is performing well. We wanna identify and understand how we correct a clarifier that is not performing well. And we wanna do everybody's favorite part, which is math, and understand the common formulas that you'll need to know to answer both questions on your exam as well as questions in real life when you become an operator and need to make sure that things are working properly. Here's a quick summary of the topics we'll cover, a little bit about how clarifiers work, what we're trying to target, some of the components, and then talk about some math. So let me start with the contaminants in wastewater and what we're trying to remove with clarification. So as you all know, there's three main categories of contaminants, and there's obviously more, but these are the big ones that we think about. Solids, BOD, or biochemical oxygen demand, and pathogens, things like bacteria and viruses that make people sick. The clarification is kind of one of the first steps of removing these contaminants. And what I have here under each box is a list of the methods of removal. So for solids, the most important method we think of is a physical removal, to do some sort of gravity settling or straining to physically remove solids. But you can also remove them through biological means, and you can also remove them through chemical means, things like enhanced precipitation. BOD removal, we generally think of biological removal, but you can also settle it out physically and remove it chemically. And pathogens, similarly, you can disinfect with chemicals, you can physically remove them, or you can biologically remove them. So the boxes I have highlighted in yellow are the physical related processes or mechanisms of removing these contaminants that you're gonna get through a clarifier. So clarifier is a big tank. We're going to slow down the water, allow particles and solids in that water to settle. And that's going to remove a lot of the solids, some of the BOD, and even some of the pathogens. So this is a broad step that kind of kicks off the removal of a lot of different types of contamination from wastewater. So let's talk a little bit more about these contaminants. In a primary clarifier, I'm gonna focus mostly on primary clarifiers because the secondary clarifiers will be covered a little more in Monty's session later. But in a primary clarifier, we've got total solids and we've got BOD coming in. So these total solids are comprised of different parts. So first you have dissolved solids. These are very, very tiny particles that are dissolved in the water. And these stay suspended even if you take a glass of water with dissolved solids in it, you're not gonna see any settling. So dissolved solids, we're gonna get very little removal in a primary clarifier process. The other fraction of solids is suspended solids. And suspended solids are going to settle. So we can get between 50 and 70% removal of suspended solids in a properly operating primary clarifier. Now, those suspended solids also have components. The first component is floatable solids. So this is what we often refer to as scum. Things like fats, oils, and greases, plastic contamination, other garbage debris that may come in the wastewater, that material is going to float, or it's going to rise to the top of the surface, and we can skim it off the top of our clarifier. We call that our clarifier scum. Then we have the settleable solids, and the settleable solids are going to be larger particles that easily settle if you give them enough time to do so. So the settleable solids, we expect that we'll remove, you know, upwards of 90% from the wastewater stream, just going through the primary clarifier process. So you can see here that the primary clarifier will be the bulk of the solids removal will happen there. And then the rest of the treatment process, we're gonna focus more on the biological and pathogen removal. The BOD, as we'll talk about here in just a minute, there's an overlap between BOD and solids. So overall, the BOD removal, we can get, you know, 25 to 35% removal in a primary clarifier. Most operators think of BOD removal as the job of the secondary treatment process. And that is true, that's the primary job of that process. But don't forget that you get a decent amount of removal in the first step of primary clarification. So a little bit on that overlap between BOD and suspended solids. So this is my little Venn diagram, right? So this is just illustrating that you've got some things that are BOD. These are organic molecules that can be degraded by bacteria and protozoa and other biological, microbiological constituents. And then you've got suspended solids. These are particles, things that can settle out in a clarifier. But I just want to point out here that there is this area of overlap. So you could have a particular particle that is both organic as well as a solid. And so when we think of the BOD fraction of, or the fractions of BOD, we've got a part that is soluble, which means it dissolves in water and will not settle out. And we've got this piece here, this overlap part, which is particulate BOD. So this is BOD that is in, you know, clusters or in clumps of particles that you actually can settle out and remove from the wastewater through a settling process like clarification. Similarly, if we look at the suspended solids fraction, we've got a lot of the suspended solids, which we call inert. These are non-reactive. This is things like sand, dirt, coffee grounds, gravel. These are particles that aren't gonna react. They're just, you know, soil and rock particles. But we have a fraction of that might be food scraps. It might be large bacteria. So it's particles that would be considered a suspended solid, but they're also organic. So we call that the biodegradable fraction of the suspended solids. So all this to say that when you put wastewater into a primary clarifier, remember we're primarily targeting the suspended solids, but in doing so, we are going to remove this overlap fraction of the BOD. So this is the particulate BOD that we can settle out in a clarifier. Okay, so that goes over some of the contaminants that we're trying to remove, but let's talk about the clarifier itself. So a primary clarifier is going to be located in the treatment process after preliminary treatment. So preliminary treatment refers to your headworks. That's your screening, your grit removal, maybe some pre-aeration, maybe some other processes. The goal of the primary clarifier is to remove those settleable solids and also any of the floatable solids, that scum material that rises to the top. These solids that you remove in a primary clarifier, they tend to be pretty high in organic concentration. And that's a good thing. That organic molecules have a lot of energy bound up in them. And so this primary sludge becomes a really rich energy source for something like an anaerobic digester. And those of you who have you know, who are familiar with anaerobic digesters know that's a process where we can degrade this high energy sludge and generate biogas, which we can use to generate electricity, generate heat, and other things. So this primary sludge is really a really great fuel source that we can use for other things in our plant. So it's, don't think of it as a waste product. Think of it as a reclaiming some beneficial product out of our, you know, out of the waste that comes to us. Okay. When we talk about a secondary clarifier operates very similarly to a primary clarifier, but the secondary clarifier is located after our biological treatment process. So generally that's going to be a trickling filter or an activated sludge tank. We'll include a secondary clarifier after that process. And the goal of that clarifier is to separate out the microorganism solids that we grew or developed in the biological process. In an activated sludge tank, we would call that the mixed liquor suspended solids. So we want to separate out the solids from the water. The water is now very clean and very low in BOD. That's going to go out and go on to our disinfection step or maybe some advanced treatment if we're doing water recycling. And that solid material will get recycled back into our biological process. So that's a stream we call the return activated sludge or the RAS. That's high microorganism concentration solids that we pump back into the biological process so those bugs can be reused and eat up more organic material. So we'll talk a little bit more about activated sludge later, and certainly in the next session, Monty will cover that in more detail. So let's look at a clarifier physically. What does it look like? What are the main components and how does it work? And this is all, you know, good information that you'll need to understand to be able to answer the questions on your certification exam. So let's start at the front end of the tank. We receive raw wastewater influent into our primary clarifier. It's generally coming in through a pipe or a series of pipes, and we put it in a long, large volume tank, which allows the water velocity to slow down. And as the water velocity slows down, that means there's not as much forward motion in the tank. And so that allows gravity to act and slowly let all of the particles in the water settle to the bottom. And so the longer we hold the water in this tank, the better settling of solids we're going to get. But as you know, the longer you hold the water in the tank, the more volume you need. So that's going to mean bigger tanks, more money, essentially. So it's a balancing act. As the water comes into the tank then, we're going to immediately start to settle solids. And those settleable solids, which are sort of shown with the brown dots in this picture, those are going to settle out of the water relatively slowly, but they'll start to settle to the bottom of this tank and be removed from the flowing water. The scum, which is shown as the purplish or pinkish dots in this diagram, that is things like your fats, oils, and greases and other floatable material. That's going to float to the top of the tank, and that material can also be collected and sent to solids handling process. The solids that settle to the bottom we refer to as the primary sludge. That is generally very watery, so we typically will send that through a thickening process to squeeze out a little bit of the water, and that sludge can be sent to your solids handling process as well. And then what you're left over with is, you know, nice, clear, low solids water. That's what we call our primary effluent. So that's the water leaving the primary clarifier. That will still have some suspended solids in it because, as I like to say, no process in water and wastewater is 100% effective, right? There's always some room for error. So even if we design a huge tank that will has a really long residence time, we'll still get some solids sneaking through. So there'll be some solids left, but mostly primary effluent with very low solids will leave this process and be ready to go on to the next process, which will usually be your secondary or biological treatment process. Okay, with the secondary clarifier, works very similarly. This diagram here shows you a picture of an activated sludge tank followed by a circular secondary clarifier. So this activated sludge will be introduced into the center of this round secondary clarifier. The water moves outward from the center point to the edges. And these little brown dots represent the solids. These are our mixed liquor suspended solids. So remember, this is organic microorganism particulates. These are going to settle to the bottom of the clarifier, and most of them will be recircled through this return activated sludge back to the front of the aeration tank. That allows for high levels of BOD removal in the aeration tank and shorter retention times because you're seeding it with already grown and thriving microorganisms. The other piece from this settled solids in the secondary clarifier is called the waste activated sludge, or the WAS, and that is basically a waste flow. That's material we're going to remove from the system. Otherwise, if we just kept recycling the microorganisms in a circle, the concentration will keep getting higher and higher and higher, and at some point that'll become a problem. So we need to keep the concentration steady, so we have to waste some of the solids as more microorganisms grow. Okay, so that's a secondary clarifier. So you've seen in my diagram so far a couple different sizes and shapes of clarifier, and I wanted to spend just a minute talking about each kind. On the top here, we have a rectangular clarifier. And generally, and there are exceptions to this, but generally primary clarifiers tend to be rectangular and secondary clarifiers tend to be circular. But I've seen circular primaries and rectangular secondaries, so that's not a hard and fast rule. With a rectangular clarifier, it is literally a rectangular basin. The water gets introduced on one of the short sides, and the water flows through from end to end. And it has a chain and flight system, is what we call this. These bars that go across are the flights. And these act as rakes to rake the sludge material along the bottom of the tank. So all the solids that settle, we rake it to a collection point. You can see right here, there's a low spot in the floor. So all of those solids that get raked to the front of the tank will collect here and you can pump that out. Then the flights, they turn around this chain system and then they skim along the top of the water. And the water level would be essentially right at the height of these flights. And so that allows these rakes to skim the surface of the water and push all of the scum to a collection point as well. So it's this one mechanical system that both helps collect the scum on top and the sludge on the bottom. In a circular tank, we need to fulfill those same goals of collecting the sludge and collecting the scum, but it's done a little bit differently because of the tank configuration. So in a circular tank, we have a collection mechanism that rotates from the center point. So there's these arms that extend along the surface and another set of rakes on arms that are below the surface. And as this clarifier mechanism slowly rotates, it's going to push all of the sludge along the bottom to a collection point. Again, something like a trough, or some clarifiers have like almost like vacuum tubes to vacuum up the sludge material. And then you'll have the arms that skim along the surface of the water, and those will push the scum to some sort of trough or channel where they can be collected and pumped onto the next process. So, you know, these clarifiers look different, they're different shapes, they take up different amount of space, and they have different mechanical components, but the function of them is the same. It's a large volume to let the water slow down and have some sort of mechanical device for collecting the sludge off the bottom and the scum off the surface, okay? We just talked about this a little bit, but a little more on the sludge collectors. So this is the chain and flight system. Here's a photo here of one of our primary clarifiers at the Fairfield-Suisun Sewer District Treatment Plant where I work. you can see the water has been drained out of this tank, but you can see these flights that this is on the top surface. So these would be the flights that skim the scum, and then they'll swing down and scrape along the bottom as well. Let's see. The primary sludge and the scum generally needs to be pumped onto the wherever it's going. In our case, and in many treatment plants' case, that's going to be to a dewatering process or a thickening process, and then on to the anaerobic digester where it can be degraded to generate biogas and therefore electricity. And here's a better view of the circular clarifier mechanism. This particular model here has this suction header, which is, this is like the vacuum style. So as this arm rotates around, it's got little holes in it and it'll suck up the sludge from the bottom of the tank. And it just keeps rotating very slowly and you know, prevents the solids from building up too high. And then on the top here, you've got this little trough and this scraper arm. So as this scraper arm circles the tank, it collects all that scum that's floating on the surface and it pushes it into this trough area where it can then be collected and pumped onto the digesters. A couple other components of clarifiers. Remember, the point in a clarifier is to have the water very slow moving and very calm. So what that means is we want to make sure that the speed of the water, the velocity of the water coming into the tank doesn't cause a lot of turbulence and churning, because that would counteract the settling that we're trying to achieve, right? So one way we can do that is with an inlet baffle. And an inlet baffle, all it is some sort of wall that the water hits so that it slows down and dissipates its energy. So we want to dissipate that influent energy, and we want to distribute the flow evenly across this whole tank. We don't want, you know, water going faster down one side of the tank than it does down the other side of the tank. Then we're going to get uneven treatment. We want it all to move very slow and very steady. The other thing that we want to make sure we accomplish is once that sludge has settled out to the bottom, we don't want to have any turbulence that's going to stir it back up. We just, you know, we have this process that's designed to settle things. We don't want our work to be undone by some turbulence. So here's a picture on a circular tank. It's a little hard to see here, but there's this gray pipe that comes up. That represents our influent pipe. So that's the wastewater coming into the tank. And then you can see there's this orange circular baffle right around it. And so what that does is it prevents the water from shooting out along the top of the tank. It forces it to go downwards, which then slows down that velocity. It's not jetting out like a garden hose. It's you know, being kind of pushed downward to better distribute that flow. And then in a rectangular tank, you'll often have something like this gray weir wall here. And that basically prevents this inlet pipe from, again, from jetting water along the top. You want to force that water to go down and better mix throughout the whole tank. Okay. Here's a picture, cross-section of the tank. Here's that inlet baffle here. Again, it's just forcing the water to go down and not just short circuit along the surface of the tank. And then the other important part is on the outlet side. So on the outlet side, we want to have effluent weirs that control the water level in the tank and make sure that, you know, we don't have any high velocity zones that could reduce the effectiveness of the settling. So this is a very typical outlet design with the V-notch weirs. The V-notch weirs allow for minimal water level change over a large range of flows. So we want to have a very constant, steady water level, whether we're treating 1 mgd through the tank or 10 mgd through the tank. And the V-notch weirs allow us to do that. I just saw a question pop up about the inlet baffles and do they help start the settling process. They can, you're right. As you direct the flow downward, you're now pushing the water in the direction that you want the solids to go. So yeah, that does help start everything moving downward. What you want to prevent, though, is such a fast downward velocity that it ends up hitting off the bottom and churning solids back up. So that's a careful balancing act, too. Good. So the importance of inlet and outlet design, the main point of it, is that we want to prevent short-circuiting. And so short-circuiting, if you think of the average time that a drop of water will spend in this tank, short-circuiting would be some path that allows water to move through much faster. And so, for example, if you didn't have that inlet baffle, you know, some of the water is going to come out of the inlet, it's going to go down to the bottom, it's going to float around and zigzag back and forth, and then some drops of water are just going to shoot right along the surface of the water and go right to the outlet pipe. That uneven distribution of time that the water spends in the tank leads to poor performance of the clarifier. So this inlet baffle helps keep all the water moving in the same direction and spending about the same time in the tank. So that's really the whole goal here, is slow and steady. All right, so now we're going to start moving into some math. And
a question here, Jordan.
Yep.
And maybe you covered it a little bit, but Skylar's asking, will exam questions for level two include velocity in primaries or range?
Yeah, so we're going to get into some of the math now, but you're right. These hydraulic parameters of these tanks, so things like detention time and flow velocity, those are definitely fair game questions for the operator exam. So, you know, make sure you brush up on those. You know, as you can tell, we're working with both rectangular tanks and circular tanks. So all of those math formulas about area and circumference of a circle, area and perimeter of a rectangle, those all factor into that math. So yes, good point, good question. That's definitely part of what you need to know. And now we're going to get into some of the more specific math formulas that are fair game for the grade 1 through 3 exam. Obviously, as you move from grade 1 to grade 3, the questions are going to get a little harder and a little more complex. But I think most of these elements could come up on any of the exams. The other thing to remember is these math formulas sometimes can help you answer questions that aren't math questions. A lot of times people don't think about it that way, but if you understand what the formula means, and then they ask you a conceptual question about, you know, what would happen if you increased the velocity of the velocity through a primary clarifier? Would the effluent concentration increase, decrease, stay the same, or not enough information? That's not in and of itself a math question, but if you understand the formulas of velocity in a tank, you could sort of work out a little example for yourself and make sure that you're getting the right answer. So just another thing to keep in mind. So let's talk about removal efficiency. Removal efficiency is not just specific to clarifiers. You'll see this formula applied to lots of different processes in both water and wastewater treatment. But that said, it's really important in clarifiers, as we discussed at the beginning, right? We talked about different removal efficiencies of different types of contamination, your suspended solids and your settleable solids. So here's the formula for removal efficiency. You take the concentration coming in, and this is the concentration of whatever the contaminant is that you're asked about. So in our case, this is usually going to be something like suspended solids. You'll take your concentration in of suspended solids, and you'll subtract out the concentration that leaves at the end of the tank. That's the concentration out, divided by the concentration coming in, and then multiply it by 100, which gets you from a decimal to a percentage. And so that gives you, or what that tells you, is that is how effective this process is at removing whatever contaminant it is that you're plugging in. So the lower the outlet concentration, the better removal efficiency you're going to get. And so for a, you know, for suspended solids, if we run our inlet and outlet concentrations across a properly functioning clarifier, you know, we would expect this number to be somewhere around 90 or 95% of settleable solids removed in that process. So inlet's what's coming in, outlet's what's going out, and then the sludge or contaminant that settles out in the process is what's being removed from that stream. And again, looking at a primary clarifier specifically, these are some of the typical numbers. And again, I'm just warning that these numbers vary from plant to plant, from location to location, but these are some general rules of thumb. In your primary clarifier, your influence suspended solids, your total suspended solids, is often in the 200 to 300 milligram per liter range. And your influent BOD is often in the 500 to 700 milligram per liter range. And so a properly functioning clarifier is going to give you a total suspended solids removal efficiency somewhere between 50 and 70%, depending on how you're operating it. BOD removals somewhere between 25 and 35% removal efficiency. And settleable solids, like we said earlier, 90 to 95%. So really good settleable solids. But again, this only works if we are operating it correctly, if we're giving the water enough time to settle. If you're pushing it, if you're pushing too much water through your process, all of these efficiencies are going to go down because you're really hurting the settling element of that clarifier. So let's do a little example. And again, we're going to move pretty quick. So I'm assuming here that you are brushed up on some basic algebra. But again, if you have any specific questions, feel free to send me an email later on, and I'm happy to walk you through any of the details in a little more depth. So what is the TSS, or total suspended solids, removal efficiency of a clarifier if the influent suspended solids are at 250 milligrams per liter and the effluent suspended solids are at 83 milligrams per liter? So this is a very straightforward removal efficiency question. So let's plug our, write down our removal efficiency formula. And I just simplified it in minus out over in times 100. These are all in concentrations. And I'm gonna plug in the numbers that we have. So I have 250 milligrams per liter of suspended solids coming in. I have 83 milligrams per liter coming out. I divide that by the in and I multiply by 100. So simplify the math here, 250 minus 83 gives me 167 divided by 250 times 100. And I get a removal efficiency of 66.8%. And so if I quickly flip back here and compare that to a typical operating clarifier where TSS removal efficiency is usually between 50 and 70%, I can say with high confidence that this is a good performing clarifier. I'm getting good removal of suspended solids in that primary clarifier. Okay. The next formula that kind of gets to Skylar's question earlier is about detention time. So this is related to that velocity question. But detention time is really important when we're talking about settling processes, because what this tells you is the average amount of time that a drop of water or a contaminant molecule is going to spend in that tank, in that clarifier. And so the longer the detention time is, the more time you have for particles to settle out. And the shorter the detention time gets, the greater the chance that some of those solids are going to reach the end of the tank before they've settled to the bottom. And then they'll go out and they'll be in your wastewater and not have been removed. The formula for detention time is a tank volume divided by an influent flow rate. Okay, so you're going to take the geometric volume of the tank and divide it by the flow rate of wastewater coming into the tank. When you simplify these math problems, you're going to find out that the units of the answer are in a time unit. So hours, days, weeks, minutes, depends on the units of the flow rate that you use, which we'll see in a minute in an example. But when you solve a detention time problem, that's always a good check to make sure that your answer comes out in a time unit. Otherwise, you might have flipped some numbers. The thing to remember about detention time is it is assuming that every drop of water is staying in there for the average amount of time. And we all know that in the real world, nothing works perfectly like a math formula, right? So every clarifier will have some amount of short circuiting, meaning that there will be some drops of water that stay in that tank much longer than your detention time, and some drops of water will stay in the tank much shorter than your detention time. But this detention time formula gives you the average time that tank holds the water. If you have too much short circuiting, then the detention time becomes a little more meaningless because, you know, it's not really reflective of what most of the water is doing. The other thing, so we talk about detention time, you want it to be long enough, but in a secondary clarifier, you can actually have a detention time that's too long. So what this is a clump of mixed liquor suspended solids that had settled to the bottom of a secondary clarifier, but it stayed in there for too long. And so what happens is if you keep your sludge in the tank for too long, it starts going anaerobic, it produces hydrogen sulfide and other gas bubbles, and it the bubbles actually lift the solids to the top, which again is the opposite of what we're trying to do. We're trying to settle things. So it is possible to have your detention time too long as well as too short. So it's important to, you know, try and keep your operation steady. And if you notice things changing, make sure you're dialing it in to an industry standard detention time, not going way longer or way shorter than the design detention time. So let's do a little math. What is the detention time measured in hours of a 1,500,000 gallon clarifier receiving a flow of 12.5 million gallons per day, or MGD? So the first thing that I want to do when I come to these detention time problems is make sure that my units are consistent. So first I want to make the volume units consistent. And what I mean by that is here I'm given a number in gallons, 1,500,000 gallons, and my flow rate is given in terms of million gallons. So it's a smaller number, it's 12.5. So I wanna just make sure that I plug in the same volume units for both parts of the formula. So that way my units cancel out and I get the right answer. So what I'm gonna do is convert everything to units of million gallons because it gives you smaller numbers and you can write less zeros. So for my volume, I'm gonna take 1,500,000 gallons and I'm gonna divide it by a million, which gets me into units of million gallons. So some of you who have done this before can probably do this in your head without writing out the math. This is, you know, the equivalent to 1.5 million gallons. Now I'm gonna write down my detention time formula and plug in what I know. So there's the formula, tank volume over influent flow. My tank volume is 1.5 million gallons. My flow is 12.5 million gallons. So when I take 1.5 divided by 12.5, my units of million gallons cancel and I end up with this D left, which is days. So my final units are in days and my final answer is 0.12 days. So I'm done, right? Well, not quite, because if you go back and read the question again, it says, what is the detention time in hours? So I need to do some unit conversion and convert 0.12 days into hours. And so if I multiply 0.12 days, I know there's 24 hours in a day. That's going to give me 2.88 hours. And I'll just give you a warning on a multiple choice operator certification test. You better believe that they're going to write down one of the possible answers will be 0.12, because they're going to count on the fact that you forgot to go back and read the question and convert it to the right units. So that's a warning I always like to give people is when you think you're done with a question, take 5 more seconds and go back and read the question again and make sure that you actually answered what it was asking for. I know that can be hard on a test when you're in a rush, you're against the time limit, but you can really catch yourself from making silly mistakes if you just take that couple extra seconds and make sure that you've answered the right question. Okay, next.
Just a time check, Jordan. We're at 10:41 right now.
Awesome, thank you. We're getting close. I'm gonna go quickly then through these last examples, and maybe I will just talk about the sort of what the formulas mean and let you look through the math on your own time. Again, if you have any questions, feel free to reach out to me and I'm happy to go through it. And we also have water and wastewater operator math classes through some of the community colleges that Levi mentioned earlier. So if you feel like you need to brush up more on this, you can take a whole semester long class going through all these formulas. So surface overflow rate is the next formula. This is a measure of how much water we're pushing into the clarifier. So it gives us a similar concept as the detention time. It's basically how hard we're pushing into the clarifier. And the more water we push in, the less chance there is for that the solids to settle out. So surface overflow rates are measured in units of gallons per day per square foot. And the thing I want you to remember about surface overflow rate is it is based on the top surface area of the tank. So like the area you see from Google Maps, right? It's not based on the cross-sectional area of the tank, which confuses people sometimes. That's just the way this unit was set up. Why they picked that cross-section, I don't entirely know, but they've developed a standard around this formula. So for the surface overflow rate, you're gonna take the influent flow and divide it by the surface area of that tank. So the influent flow will usually be in MGD or gallons per day. And the surface area, you want it in square feet. So you can get to these units of gallons per day per square foot. And so basically what that means is for every square foot on the surface of that tank, how many gallons of water are being applied to it per day. And typical values are gonna be in the 800 to 1200 gallons per day per square foot range for a primary clarifier. And if it's any higher than that, you're hydraulically overloading that tank, meaning you're pushing more water than it's designed to handle. And you're gonna start churning up solids and have poor treatment. If the surface overflow rate is too high, then you wanna reduce the flow into the clarifiers. If you have something like wastewater equalization, but usually what people do, if your surface overflow rate is too high, you put another clarifier into service. Now you increase the surface area and you're treating the same amount of flow, so you can lower the surface overflow rate. And surface overflow rate is directly related to detention time, right? The more water you push in, the faster all that water is gonna move through the tank. So we wanna have, you know, 1 to 3 hour detention time is the goal for a clarifier. Again, I'm gonna jump through this real quick, but you can, you know, you basically need to calculate the surface area of your tank, check all your units, and then plug it into the surface overflow rate formula. I'll let you read through that in your own time rather than reading you numbers. And I'm gonna skip through this one as well just to make sure we get to the last topic here, which is weir overflow rate. Weir overflow rate is another way of measuring this hydraulic loading. It is, let me just jump to the formula. It is the influent flow divided by the total weir length. And so the weir length, now we're talking about the outlet end of the tank, how the water leaves that tank. And the length really depends on the shape and the configuration of your tank. Generally, we're gonna want to see numbers between 5,000 and 15,000 gallons per day per foot. So remember the hydraulic overflow rate was per square foot. That was an area. In this case, we're measuring it per a length of weir. So this will just be per foot. And just remember that, especially in a primary tank, we usually have these effluent weirs that stick out into the tank. So when you count the weir length, you need to count every surface that water is overflowing. So in this case, these two troughs, the water spills over into the trough on both sides. So I have 1, 2, 3, 4 surfaces that water's being collected from. So I'm going to take the length of that weir and multiply it by 4. If I add one more trough, I now have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 sides of the weirs that the water will overflow. So I have to take that trough length times 6. Just something to keep in mind. Same thing, the weirs can often be oriented the other way, perpendicular to the tank. And I have an example of that. So I think, well, we've got just a couple minutes left, right, Robert? So let's see. I don't think I see any questions at this time. I'm going to pause and just give everyone a chance to type in any questions if you have any for me to answer before our time is up here.
Yeah, you can type your question in, or you can just sound your question out. It's 36 of us here, so if you have a question, just unmute yourself and ask it. Okay.
Okay. In that case, let me just double check a couple more examples. If there's no questions, I'm just going to spend the last 2 minutes here and just talk about one other helpful formula, which is making sure you understand how to measure or how to calculate the total solids of the sludge that's produced from your clarifier. So the sludge weight, to find the sludge weight, we're going to take the total weight of all the solids in the water plus the water in that sludge mixture. And so to find my total solids weight, I'm going to take the sludge weight and multiply it by the percent total solids. And again, we have to have this divided by 100 because we're switching between decimals and percentages. The other way to write that is to find the percent total solids, I need to take the total weight of solids and divide it by the total weight of sludge. And so just remember that sludge by definition means solids and water. So I'm just finding the fraction of the solids in water that are solids. And the handy conversion factor is I can convert percent total solids to a concentration with this 10,000 factor. So if I take the concentration divided by 10,000, that'll give me a percent solids. And similarly, if you algebra this around, you can take a percent total solids, multiply it by 10,000, and that'll give you the concentration in milligrams per liter. So with that basically covers what I wanted to cover today. Very quick session. So sorry that we had to rush through things. But as I said, I'm happy to take any questions right now or feel free to follow up with me. I really hope that you all get something out of this workshop today, and that you feel slightly more prepared for your operator certification tests. We're all glad that they're actually happening again, and we're looking forward to having you all join us in the field, and I hope to see you all in classes and at industry meetings in the future. So,
thank you so much, Jordan. We really appreciate you doing this. Great presentation. And this is the time, we have a few minutes where if you wanna to give a comment or share some experience, this is an opportunity also for you guys to learn from each other. So if you've taken some of the exams and you know the grade 2 to grade 3, I'm sure someone who hasn't done that yet would appreciate anything that you'll like to say to them in this time. We have a few minutes, so you can do that as well. So you can just unmute your mic and sound off if you like.
Anyone that's taken the exam have a problem that tripped them up? You want to give a word of warning to everybody else? That is a really good way to prepare for these exams, is to, you know, talk to other folks who have done it, because, you know, there's only so many questions they can ask. So the more people you talk to, you get a sense of what's on the test and kind of know where to spend your study time.
Again, I'm verifying if we can access all the slides in the website.
Absolutely. They'll be there.
It's a very good slide.
Also, I'm going to put a link to a survey, and we'd like for you to complete that. You can either do it through the link, or you'll also receive an email of it. And this is a Survey Monkey survey. It's just a few questions on there. It won't take you very long to complete. So we really want to hear from you, as we take these things very seriously, and we try to make this experience as great for you as possible. So we are always looking to improve.
Yeah, great. I did just see a comment pop up that that maybe the way I did the algebra is different than the way you've seen it from other places. So I usually say that, and I didn't for time purposes today, but everybody does math differently, and everyone's brain works differently with math. So the way I do it is the way I learned to do it 20 years ago. And, you know, that's just the way my brain works. If you are familiar with like the train tracks method for converting formulas or converting units from one to another, and that works for you, that's totally okay. As long as you pick a method that makes sense to you, you understand how to do it, and you can consistently get the right answer, awesome. So if the way I converted units or the way I did the math is confusing to you, you know, feel free to reach out to me and we can talk through it or try to relate it more to, you know, the way that you would work through it on your own.